All right. I think with people still trickling in, but if you agree, we can start. And
Yes.
so then let me reintroduce Professor Vincenzo Savona. He's been an ardent supporter of the school and gave the introductory lecture on Monday in case you missed that. And so I'm just gonna repeat who he is and what he's doing. So he did his PhD at EPFL. In theoretical physics. Then he did postdoctoral work first in EPFL, then at the Humboldt University in Berlin. In 2002, he received a Professor Bourezier Fellowship from the Swiss National Science Foundation. And then since 2006, he's a professor at EPFL, where he directs the Laboratory of Theoretical Physics of Nanosystems. And today he's talking about Shor's algorithm.
Yeah, thank you very much. So the lecture will be very different in style from Tuesday's one because it will be handwritten, okay, like in class, like theoretical physicists do. And we have a lot of things to do, so I'll better hurry up and start. Okay, so let me share my screen. Okay, so we are going to talk about Shor's algorithm, okay? I would like this thing to write, but I changed. Okay. So Shor's algorithm is perhaps the most popular, by far, the most popular quantum algorithm out there for a number of reasons. I would like to now dwell into discussing this, but what is important is that Shor algorithm finds a prime factor of an integer in time order of n cube of, pardon, sorry, that would be very bad. Log n cubed. Okay, too many parentheses. Okay. And the best known classical algorithm requires order of e to the 1.9, I'm reading out, log n to the 1/3, and this is what computer scientists call sub-exponential, log n to the 2/3, still exponential, okay? Now, Shor's algorithm is a beautiful combination of basic quantum algorithms, quantum subroutines, and number theoretical results. And my very ambitious goal is to summarize all this here. I was very relieved this morning when I heard that you already did the quantum Fourier transform. So what we are going to need today will be the quantum phase estimation. And what I hear is that you did, which includes the quantum Fourier transform. Now, what I hear is that you saw already the quantum Fourier transform, so I'm going to give you a very brief reminder of what it does. And I'm going to make an introduction to the quantum phase estimation algorithm, which will then be needed for sure, okay? So let's talk about quantum phase estimation, quantum Fourier transform first, okay? I just recall what it is. So the quantum Fourier transform essentially carries out a discrete Fourier transform on a quantum computer. So let me start with the discrete FT, which does the following. So you have n complex number, x1, xn, okay, xn minus, sorry, x0, xn minus 1, okay, and you compute yk equal 1 over square root of n, sum j equals 0 to n minus 1 of xj times e to the 2 pi I jk divided by n. This is the discrete Fourier transform that you have certainly seen in many places. Now, what QFT does is essentially that it takes computational basis, which, as we discussed last time, is just the states with the classical bit set, so 0, 1, all the way to state n minus 1. It's a register that can host up to n, so a number up to n. So we are assuming here that n is equal to 2 to the power of n, okay? And essentially, the quantum Fourier transform does the following. If you take the state j, it goes through quantum Fourier transform to the state 1 over square root of n, sum k equals 0 to n minus 1, the same coefficients as before, 2 pi I j k over n times k. So it does this thing essentially, okay? This is a unitary transformation. It's not obvious from this formula, but we will see it later on because we are able to write a circuit for it. So it must be unitary, okay? It's very useful for the quantum Fourier transform to take a number j and write it in terms of like in base 10, you write the digits. It's useful to write the binary digits. So you can write the number j as j1, 2 to the n minus 1, plus j2, 2 to the n minus 2, plus jn, 2 to the 0, okay? So each of these j, j1, jn is the binary digit of j, okay? So the number j is in binary notation is j1, j2, j, n, binary notation. So what is useful here is to consider the number j over n, so which is a fractional number, okay? Because j is at most big n minus 1, and this is equal to j divided by 2 to the n, as I said, which is equal to j1 over 2 plus j2 over 4 plus jn over 2 to the power of n. And this object is sometimes written with the binary notation for fractional numbers, which is essentially O point J1, J2, Jn, okay? So this is exactly like when you write a number smaller than one in decimal representation, okay? It's a 0 point something. This is the same thing, 0 point something, but in binary, okay? Where the digits are binary. And this is useful because it makes expression much simpler. And just to speed up things, I cut and pasted my circuit for QFT in my handwritten notes. You can see it, I hope. You can see the picture, right? Okay. So this is the quantum circuit. And one thing that I want to make clear, perhaps I make it things here a bit smaller so that I can write below. One thing that I want to make clear that the Fourier transforms, now I'm writing J, remember this is equal to J1, Jn, okay? It's the bit set is this one. This goes to that sum, but that sum can be written in a very smart way because actually a vector from the computational basis, which is a separable non-entangled state, goes into a non-entangled state. So it's a zero plus e to the 2 pi I 0.jn times 1 0 plus e to the 2 pi I 0.jn minus 1 jn times 1 all the way to 0 plus e to the 2 pi I 0.j1jn times 1. All this divided by square root of 2 to the n. This fact for me is very fascinating. So the quantum Fourier transform does not entangle. If you input this kind of separable states, the computational basis, the output is not entangled. Okay, it's a bit oversimplified said like this, but it's a very important thing that would deserve a lot of discussion in itself. Anyway, the circuit works like this, and you have seen it. This is the basic circuit for QFT. I don't want to repeat how it works because you have already learned it. The only thing that I want to notice is that in the end, there are many variants of QFT. There are QFT circuits that save on many different respects. In particular, there are approximate circuits for QFT, and if we wanted to write an algorithm for something, then this task deserves a lot of thinking and brainstorming in order to see whether we can use some smart shortcut computing the QFT. Okay, this is a topic of research in itself, but fine. Okay. And this is all what I have to say about the quantum Fourier transform. Okay, so now I would like really to go to the second topic, which is the quantum phase estimation. So I'm still switching, I'm again switching a page. By the way, this, I'm a bit quick, but this rotation R2, Rn minus one, these are rotations by 2 pi over n. Around Z. So these are basic rotations around Z, okay? But this is very standard. Okay, now let me switch to quantum phase estimation, okay? So quantum phase estimation does the following. Okay, suppose that you have a unitary U on n qubits. Okay, and suppose that U is an eigenvector. That is to say that U applied to U is an eigenvalue, and the eigenvalue will be e to the I phi u. Why it is like this? Well, because it's a unitary, and the unitaries don't change the norm of vectors. Okay, so the eigenvalues of unitaries are necessarily complex phases with modulo one. Okay, now. What quantum phase estimation does is knowing U, the state, or an approximation thereof, okay, finds phi with large probability. Okay, you might say, but wait a moment. If I know U, I can compute. No, because remember, complexity is measured in terms of resources, not in terms of time. Okay, we are talking of numbers that can be exceedingly large because we have the exponential, okay? If n qubits is large, then you will be unable to store the vector u, and you will be unable also to apply the matrix to the vector classically because it's too big. Okay, so this is a complex task. This is actually an exponentially complex task for a classical computer, okay? And we will see that the quantum phase estimation does this very, very efficiently, okay? The trick is the following. We have two registers. Maybe I should show already the circuit, but I will wait a moment. So first of all, notice that that phi can be rewritten as 0. Phi one, phi two, phi t, okay? Because if this is, this phi is expressed modulo one, so as a number smaller than one, because there is a 2π in the exponent, as you can see, and therefore, if this is larger than one, then it will just subtract a factor. So it will just generate a factor of one. So you can assume that phi is of this form, okay? Always, because of the way the eigenvalue is written. Okay. Now there is a point. This number could be any, and this t is a parameter. It's the number of qubits of a second register that we will use. I will show this in a moment. So we have to choose this number, okay? And now there are two possibilities. So we will assume, because I can't go through all the details of the quantum phase estimation. We will assume that phi, that 2 to the n times phi is a t qubit. No, sorry, 2 to the t, what I'm writing. 2 to the t. Okay. 2 to the t times phi is a t qubit integer. So essentially, we are assuming that this writing is exact, so that phi has exactly t digits, t binary digits. This could not be the case. If it's not the case, then what happens is that the quantum Fourier transform gives you an approximate result for phi with a high probability. But we will not cover this case because we don't have much time. So I will really stick to this assumption that this is exact, okay? So essentially, if I choose t qubits, then I can represent the number phi or 2 to the n, 2 to the t times phi exactly, okay? Okay, now that we say this, then we can go to the circuit. The circuit is here. I hope you can see it, and I'm going to make it a bit smaller, okay? Okay, the circuit is made of three parts. The first part, I would like to point, but I only have the, yeah, never mind. So the circuit is made of three parts. The first part is, do I have a pointer here? Review on one note. I would like to have a pointer, but unfortunately, I don't have it. Okay, never mind. Never mind. The first part, we have two registers. The first register is supposed to store u. Okay. The first register has the eigen vector as an input. We may ask the question: how are we going to input a specific state to a circuit? And this is a big problem in quantum computing. But don't worry, because in the specific case of Shor, there will be a way to do so. Okay. The other register, which is if you want an auxiliary register, contains t qubits, and it's the register that is used to record the eigenvalue at the end of the calculation, okay? And the first register is input with zero, and then you apply a sequence of Hadamard. Now you will understand by now that this trick of applying a sequence of Hadamard is very standard and is very powerful, because essentially you set the state into the the superposition of all states of the computational basis, okay, with constant coefficients. And this is one of the requirements if you want to take advantage in some way of quantum parallelism. Okay, so this Adamart thing at the beginning is very common in quantum computing. Okay, so I mean, I don't want to oversimplify, but many circuits, many algorithms start with this. Okay, then we have we need the oracles. So we need circuits that are able to carry out controlled U operations. Okay, this is needed. And we will see that in the specific case of Shor, there is a possibility to do so. And then, and you have to be able to do the same thing with powers of U, but this, if you can do it with U, you can do with powers. And the final step is the quantum Fourier transform, is the inverse quantum Fourier transform that we have here, okay? We will see why, recalling the formula that I showed in the previous slide, okay? Now this circuit, written in this way, has a very nice property, which is the fact that I mean, if you look, for example, what happens at the first qubit, okay, the first qubit has zero. I will do only the first qubit to convince you. So the first qubit is at zero, and the input of the second register is at U. So we are representing here the first qubit of the first register and the entire second register. Now you have an Adamart, okay? And the Adamart brings you to zero plus one over square root of two times U, okay? And this, I want to write it as one over square root of U, zero U plus one, U. Why? Because now I'm going to apply, look, in the circuit, the first qubit has a control on this operation here. Okay, so now I'm going to apply this. So by applying the controlled U to the 2t minus 1, I end up with 1 over square root of 2. And here I have zero times U, because if the first qubit is zero, nothing happens, plus, and here I have one, and then I have a U to the two to the T minus one times U, but this is an eigen vector. So this is equal, I continue writing here, this is equal to one over square root of two, zero U plus one, e to the 2 pi i phi to 2 to the t minus 1, because it's a u to the 2 to the t minus 1 times u. Okay. And this now I can rewrite as 1 over square root of 2, which for times 0 plus e to the 2 pi I phi 2 to the t minus 1 times 1 u. Okay, so look, 0 goes to this. Two things. You see that the controlled u acts on the second register. Okay, it's here. Okay. However, this has, in this particular case, but this is a very common scheme in quantum algorithms, it is very, very frequently used. As a result, it brings you a phase on the first qubit. This phenomenon is called the phase kickback. And it's very commonly used in quantum algorithms. So you use the fact that you have a linear combination of the first register, and depending on which is the term in the linear combination, the second register provides a phase. Well, this phase will be kicked back to the first register in exactly this way. Okay, so this phase kickback is a term that is heard very frequently in quantum computing. And so I wanted to highlight what it is. The second fact is that if you look at this object, if you look at this object here is just, sorry if I switch, so this factor is exactly, I go back one slide, is exactly the factor that you have here. It's exactly this thing, if you think of it, okay, in the quantum Fourier transform. So now if you repeat the same thing on all the qubits, you remember that each qubit has a different power of u. At the end, we will have phase here, we will have exactly all the states that are output at the end of the for each qubit in a separable fashion, all the states that are at the output of the quantum Fourier transform, with the number, with the integer number corresponding to the integer that expresses the phase phi. And so you understand that because of that, applying now the inverse quantum Fourier transform will give us exactly the eigenvalue, the exponent. And this is exactly the what the quantum phase estimation, the simplest form of the quantum phase estimation does. Okay. There is a lot. So essentially the overall effect of QPE is to send zero U into phi U. And this is equal to phi one, phi two, phi n U. So this is a vector of the computational basis, which means that the measurement on the computational basis will give you phi with probability one. Okay. Of course, this is not true because phi will never be a t. This is t, it's not n. I'm sorry for this. This is t. Okay. So I'm not, I'm skipping the discussion of what happens if phi is not exactly a t bit integer, and I'm skipping what happens in case instead of inputting u, you input a state that has a large overlap with u, but it's not quite u. Okay, but this is all dealt with in the literature, and essentially you end up with an algorithm such that if you choose t sufficiently large but still logarithmically large, okay, you can approximate the eigenvalue with the high accuracy and high probability with an overhead which is of the polynomial in the number of qubits, not exponential. Okay, so this is the essence of the quantum phase estimation. Okay, and it's actually so perhaps this I should say. If you have a requirement, phi accurate to m bits, and you want this result with probability p equal 1 minus epsilon, then these two things imply that you have to choose a t equal to m plus the floor of the logarithm of 2 plus 1 over 2 epsilon. This is a result that you can prove. So you see, you need a number of qubits, which is small. Okay, everything goes so there is nothing that is exponential in t or exponential in m. And this is a very good news. Okay. I slow down a bit. Are there any questions about these two parts which are preliminary to Shor?
So I actually had a question, but it's not about the math, it's about the what you can do classically. I was wondering which parts of these can be done, like quantum phase estimation, quantum Fourier transform. You put it out of
so this is a very complex topic because defined classically. So the problem is the following. A quantum computer does not talk, I mean, nature evolves according to the states, but the only thing that you can get from a quantum computing is the readout of the state. Okay, readout of state means that you get just one component on the computational basis with some probability, and then you forget about everything else. And then you have to repeat if you want to measure another one, okay? So there is this notion which is common in the field of classical simulation of quantum circuits, which has become a field, research field, which is called the notion of weak simulation. So in strong simulation, you simulate the whole state that comes out of a quantum computer. But you don't need to do that. The only thing you need to do is to sample the outcome of the measurements in with the same probabilities. And this is called the weak simulation. Now, weak simulation, it's quite simple to show that the weak simulation and strong simulation do not coincide at all. One can show examples in which a strong simulation is untreatable while weak simulation is trivial. Okay. So the right question is, can you weakly simulate?
Yes.
Okay. And now this comes the fun, because so quantum Fourier transform, if the input, you have seen that if the input is a vector of the computational basis, the quantum Fourier transform can be simulated classically because the output is separable. So so it's very easy. Okay, yeah. Everything, okay. So you may ask the question, how is it that QFT is difficult? Well, the consensus is that the QFT is computationally heavy if the input is, anti-concentrated. So if the input has a number of components on the computational basis or equivalently on another basis, which is exponential, which is not polynomial in small n. Okay. So if you have if you would take the quantum Fourier transform, you put an input where only a polynomial number of coefficients in the state are non-zero, this can be simulated classically efficiently. With the concept of weak simulation, okay? It's only when the input itself is anti-concentrated, so has a lot of coefficients in the computational basis, so exponentially many, okay? Order of big N. It's only in that case that the quantum Fourier transform can't be simulated classically. So you see it's subtle.
I see, okay. So if you can write down the state, then you can do it on a normal computer.
Exactly. Well, yes, let's put it this way. And now Shor, this is the comment. I make it now because I'm sure that we'll be in a rush at the end. So Shor is two blocks. Shor is quantum phase estimation, essentially. Yes. It's quantum phase estimation with a particular kind of unitary. Okay. Now, this particular kind of unitary can be efficiently simulated classically. The Fourier transform can be efficiently simulated classically if the input is of some kind. Well, it turns out that in Shor, and it is a conjecture because it's not clear, this intermediate state that goes from the controlled unitary, which will be modular exponentiation, to the QFT is conjectured to be anti-concentrated. So, using your words, it can't be written down.
Yeah.
We will see that this is the order of the, so it's a period, and I will try to be more precise later. So the reason why Shor can't be simulated classically is very subtle, because Shor is made of two pieces and each piece can be simulated classically.
Yeah. Yeah.
But in the middle, you have a state which is too big. And so this is why I find Shor fascinating for this reason. Okay.
see. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, so now we stop. I don't, perhaps there are other questions.
So there are no questions in the chat, but of course, if anyone has a more questions, feel free to ask.
Actually, I have a question.
Okay.
So basically, okay, we know that quantum phase estimation is regarded as the way to solve eigenvalue problems of the future when we will have a, let's say, fault-tolerant quantum computer.
Yeah.
Of course, it requires the knowledge of the eigenstate that is u. So the idea is that u is determined like using variational principles, and then like we calculate the energy and we try to minimize the energy in order to get u in that case.
So, I mean, of course, here we go a bit off topic. For the moment, I mean, quantum phase estimation is now considered as obsolete if the goal is to compute eigenvalues. I mean, it's completely, I mean, now there are extremely sophisticated methods that are variational, like you are, I mean, all what we're talking about requires a fault-tolerant quantum computer. So until we have a fault-tolerant quantum computer, Shor is impossible. I mean, you can do it on small numbers, but it's of no use, okay? And this is essentially because quantum phase estimation is a fault-tolerant algorithm, so it requires fault-tolerant computers. There is a huge literature on Shor where people try to fix things so that it can be made as quickly as possible, but there is no big success. There is a work, a very recent work by Alan Spurogutzik about a variational quantum factoring algorithm, which is essentially an algorithm where the factoring problem is translated into an optimization problem, and then the QAOA is used. Completely different from Shor. On paper, it works. But the landscape of the cost function may be so complex that the optimization algorithm doesn't work efficiently. And this we don't know. I mean, there is an example in the paper which is of course small, not very small, but smallish. So this is all theory. Eh? In practice, nobody is able to factor very big numbers with Shor, not even with the improved versions of Shor out there. Okay, so we must be clear about this thing. Okay, but still, Shor is the quintessential quantum algorithm. This is why it's so beautiful. So it's pedagogically, it's really very, very important. Okay, so Shor. Shor is a brilliant combination of number theoretical results, and which I will not prove, not at all. Okay, so because otherwise we will take hours. Okay, but you will see that there is if you think long enough, there is an intuition to what happens. Okay, so Shor is based on the problem of order finding then which I will explain. Then there is a link between order finding and period finding. Okay, which I will also explain. And then there is a link between period finding and and factoring. So this is our plan. So I will start with the order finding, okay? And so let's talk about order finding and explain what it is. Okay, so order finding is the following thing. So if G is a finite group, I will also have to assume that you have a familiarity with group theory, with the elementary group theory, okay? Finite group, then the number of elements of G, H, is the number of elements of G. This is called the order of G of the group. Okay. This is not the order we are interested in. The order we're interested in is another one, which is also called the order. Okay. So let me define the order of an element A of G is the smallest positive integer R such that A to the R is equal to the identity, so to the neutral element of G, okay? So this is the idea. So essentially, if you take a group, whatever, and you take an element and you apply the internal composition rule of the group, which perhaps by simplification of terminology we will call the product or the multiplication, but it's not in general. It's a law that comes from the table, the multiplication table of the group. Okay, so if you take one element and you start taking powers of this element, at some point you will end up on E. And this is a theorem. So essentially, so this theorem which is called the Lagrange theorem, which says that for finite groups, G, R is a divisor of H. So the order of an element for each element, the order is a divisor of the order of the group. Okay, so clearly R is smaller or equal to H. Okay. So it exists and it's finite. Okay, this is very important. This number always exists. Okay, and it's not so obvious to find this number for a group, for big groups. Okay, and we will see that we will focus exactly on the problem of finding this R for a particular group that I'm now going to define. Okay, so, we are interested in the group, in the following group. So consider, the group we are interested in is called Zn star, and I have to explain what it is. So Zn is just the set of numbers 0, 1, 2, all the way up to n minus 1. Okay. N is the number to factor. Okay. This is the input of the problem. Okay. And this Zn is just this simple set of numbers. Now, Z star n is the set of all elements. So it is the set of all numbers from 0 to n minus 1 such that the greatest common denominator of A and n is equal to 1. What does it mean? It means that it's the set of all numbers from 0 to n minus 1 which are coprime to n. So where A and N have not a common denominator, a common divisor, okay? This is the definition of this group. And we will see, don't try too much to understand why we need this group, because it will become clear with the theorems that I will state, not prove, in the following, in a few minutes, okay? So It turns out that Z star N is a group under the operation A, B modulo N. What does it mean? It means that if you take two numbers A and B in Z and star, okay, and you make that their product but modulo N, so if you overflow with respect to N, you subtract N, okay, then you can show very easily that this is a group. So this is important. And as I said, since we are limited in time, I won't show that this is the case, okay? So this makes it possible, the fact that this is a group is very important because we can apply a lot of theorems. And in particular, we can define we can solve the order finding problem. So the order finding problem is take given N and A, which is an element of Zn star, okay, find the order of A. That is to say, find the smallest r such that A to the r is equal to the identity, is equal to one, essentially, is equal to, one modulo n. Okay, that's the identity in the group. It's one, but it one modulo n because we are working modulo n. Okay. So essentially we want that, this should be written in a different way. It should be written as A to the R mod N is equal to one. That's what we are searching, okay? Okay, great. So this is the order finding problem, okay? Let me make an example. Suppose that, suppose that N is equal to 35 and A is equal to 4. You see that 4 does not divide, it has no common divisor with 40, with 35. So this is a member or this is an element of Zn star, okay? Now we can try. So 4 to the 1 is equal 4, 4 to the 2 is equal 16, 4 to the 3 is equal 29. Which is still smaller than 35. 4 to the 4 would be equal to, why did I write 4 to the 3 is 16 times 4, it's 64 minus 35 is 29. So this is modulo 2. So 4 to the 4 is equal to 11 modulo 35. 4 to the 5 is equal to 9 modulo 35, and 4 to the 6 is equal to 1 modulo 35. So R equals 6 for this particular case. Okay. Now you see this is easy, but you will see that for this particular group it's not so easy. Okay. Now, as I told you, and then perhaps we may take a small break. As I told you, there is a link between order and period finding. Because we can define a function f of x, okay, which is equal to A of X modulo N, okay? With A in Zn star. This function has a period R. Okay, so f of x is periodic. With period R. And this is quite obvious, huh? Because a to the R modulo n is one per definition. Okay, so when you keep going, you restart from the beginning, and then you will hit another times one when you arrive to 2R and so on. So this is quite obvious. Okay. You may say, but all this is strange. I mean, what's this function and so on? You can't imagine how much you had to do in the past with this function. Although perhaps you don't know it, because random numbers on quantum computers are generated this way. So random numbers are generated through this object. So you take a big N, you take an A, which is coprime to N, and then you start iterating x, okay? And you can find, you start computing f of x. And f of x is pseudo-random. So f of x looks exactly like random numbers. Actually, it is the way random numbers are generated on your computer, okay? And when you hit the period, it's bad. Why it's bad? Because it's no longer random. And then your simulation goes completely berserk because you were hoping it was random, but it's not. Okay? And sometimes you don't even realize and you get the wrong result with correlations if you use a bad random number generators, which today in 2021, it's no longer the case. But 20 years ago, I fell in a pitfall like this using a poor random number generator. So your generation will never experience this, but know that this is the way random numbers are generated, which tells you how difficult it is to find R, because if this thing is used to generate random numbers, it means that it must have a huge period, because it must be foolproof, your random number generator on your computer. And so you understand why, where the difficulty in this problem of finding R hides, okay? It's not difficult for every A or for every N, but for us, you can find some for which it is extremely difficult. Okay. Now I can show you how this is done with a quantum computer. Okay. So this is all preliminary part of number theoretical facts. Now I will show how to find the period with a quantum computer. And afterwards, I will introduce two more theorems to show how this links to factoring, okay? But perhaps this is a good time to invite questions and to ask and to make a small break. So are there any questions about this? Okay, I would say we can start back. I answered a couple of questions on the question and answer forum.
Oh yeah, thank you.
So I share my screen again. As always, this thing, one note has a bug that when you share, unshare and reshare, it doesn't move. Okay. So now what I want to do now is to describe the quantum order finding algorithm. Okay, and this is possible with quantum phase estimation using the following unitary. U applied on a number of the basis of the computational basis is equal to another number, another state of the computational basics, which is xy mod n. Remember, n is an input. N is the number that we want to factor, okay? So this is a very simple unitary. It's a unitary that brings a computational basis to computational basis, okay? But it does it in a very clever way by by computing the product with the number x, so it's a u that depends on x, okay? And then takes, so it multiplies and then takes the modulo n, okay? So now y is a number which is made of L qubits, okay? And L is chosen as the floor of log on basis 2 of n. So essentially L is the number of bits, of binary bits that you need to represent n, okay? And of course, since big N is not necessary, is never a power of 2, then you will have empty slots. So L will represent a bigger, can represent an even bigger number than N. So you define definition. So you have to set, in order to make sure that that U is defined for all numbers and that the algorithm works, you have to set, this is a detail, but it's important, U of Y equal to Y, if n smaller or equal y smaller or equal to l minus one. Okay, so essentially you make this choice. This choice gives you more room that what you need to than what you need to represent n, because it gives room till the next power of two larger than n. And so you have to decide what you do with these numbers, and you do this, okay? And this is required, otherwise the algorithm doesn't work. Okay, it's detailed but important. Now, why is it possible using QP? Look, it's very simple. I mean, you need the I still don't know how David Shor thought of this. Probably he was an expert in number theory, but okay. So the idea is the following. Take a vector, which depends on an integer s, and which is defined in this way, 1 over square root of r, sum k equals 0 to r minus 1 of the exponential of minus 2 pi I s k over r times the number times the state x to the power of k modulo n. We are always playing with this modular operations, okay? Now if you look at this vector, at this state, well, this state has an important feature. It's an eigenstate of U. And in fact, if you compute U, US, you get 1 over square root of R, sum k equals 0 to R minus 1 of the exponential of minus 2 pi I S k over r. And now what does u do on this object? Multiplies by x, because we have defined it this way. So it will be x to the k plus 1 modulo n. But this object essentially just gives you a phase, because now I can extract a phase because of k that is here. I can rewrite this as, I mean, it takes a couple of lines of algebra, but it's very simple, it's straightforward. As exponential of 2 pi I s over r, because you see here you have k plus 1, so if you modify the sum, so do I have k plus 1, you have a plus 1 that you can extract, times us. Okay, so we're done, because we can apply QP. To find S over R, and this will give you R. That is a problem. there are two problems. Huh? So two problems which we are going to solve. First, how to input US for a given S. US depends on R, we don't know R. Huh? So the problem is, first of all, how to input a state to a quantum computer. This is humongously difficult. Second, we don't know R, so we don't know the state US, okay? And the second problem is how to code C U to the J, or U to the 2 to the J, okay? So the first problem is solved quite brilliantly. Well, let me first talk about the second problem, okay? The second problem is called the controlled U to the power of J, U to the 2 to the power of J is called is called the modular exponentiation. I will talk about this in a moment. And this problem, so you can compute, this is a classically treatable. Okay, you can look it up. There are algorithms for this. So I don't know if somebody told you, probably not, because that should have been me on Tuesday. Whatever is classically treatable is also on paper quantum treatable. Why? Because the quantum computing paradigm is a superset of classical computing, okay? You can use quantum gates to mimic, so to reproduce a universal set of classical gates efficiently. And therefore you can always write a classical algorithm on the quantum hardware in principle. So this is just the formal proof that whatever is classically treatable is also treatable on a quantum computer, okay? So this is not a problem to write these things, and I'm not going to insist on this part because this becomes very technical. And once I looked it up, and there is a lot of literature about people that that have fun in super optimizing the modular exponentiation quantum algorithm. Okay, so there are papers out there, and you can read them; they are very interesting. Okay. What I like is the solution of the first problem, okay? The problem one is solved in this way. Notice that 1 over square root of r sum s equals 0 to r minus 1 of us is equal to 1. You can take the expression for US and so exercise at home. Okay, and run this computation and see that it's equal to 1, which is good. Why? Because now let us input 1 to QP. So there was a question, how do we input? You see, now the vector to input is simple. What will happen is that the QPE will output 1 among the eigenvalues S over R, okay, these are the exponents, okay, with high probability. So this is written in bad English. It means that the probability that what you get is none among the eigenvalues S over R is very small, okay? So you will get one of those, randomly, but one of those, okay? And this is good because now what you can do is that, if you run once, you will get S over R for some S unknown. Okay. But these two are integers, so S and R are integers. So you can guess them from S over R. So you have a number and you can guess S and R. And there is a huge literature about this. For example, using the method of continued fractions, continued fractions. Which gives you the result. I think in order of L cubed, where L is the number of qubits. So it's, but in general, in poly order of poly L, of polynomial in L. Okay. So what you can do also is that you can run several times. Eh? So you get S1 over R, S2 over R, and so on. And you can think of more sophisticated methods to extract R from fractions that you know as a decimal number, and you want to understand which fraction it is. Okay, so there are methods there, and they are all polynomial. So we don't care about this. We know that we can use now quantum phase estimation, which is polynomial in L. So now we have that quantum order finding is order of poly L, which is what we wanted, because now we know that we can find the order in polynomial number of operations. Okay. Yes. So. That's. I mean, I'm not insisting. Once again, I'm skipping the part in which I discuss how to implement this. This is discussed in many places. You can look up the Nielsen and Chuang, because once again, it can be done. It's technical, but there are ways to do this. Okay, it's not simple. So you have to build circuits that do this for large numbers, but there are methods to do so. There are people who have devised systematic ways to write modular exponentiation circuits on a quantum computer. Okay, and if you do this, then you end up with this circuit for Shor's algorithm. This is in the abridged notation, in which we use one line for a register. And you see that we have the T qubit register with input zero, the L qubit register with input one, remember, which is easy. Mm-hmm. Then you have the many Hadamard. And then you have, this is a simplified notation for the control, the modular exponentiation. Okay, here is essentially what we are saying is that X, so what we are saying is the following, that if you have X, Y that goes to X, U to the X, T, 2 to the t minus 1, u to the x t t minus 1, 2 to the t minus 2. So it's exactly the kind of operation that we have to apply all the way times u to the x1, 2 to the 0, which is 1, applied on y. Well, this object can be rewritten as x times the state x to the, oh, I'm sorry, I should have used a different number here. Sorry, this was, let me correct this, okay? So I need the z, not an x, otherwise it doesn't work. Sorry. Okay. Z. This is z times, and now you have x to the zt, 2 to the t minus 1. We are playing this trick. If zt is 0, this does nothing. And if zt is 1, then this does the exponentiation, okay? And this is times x to the zt minus 1, 2 to the t minus 2, times x to the z1, 2 to the 0, times y mod n. So this is the definition of u. The definition of the operation of the unitary u is this. And if you have a sequence of this, then you have this product, and this product is nothing but, sorry, z, and here you have x to the z mod times y mod n. Okay, so this is the operation that you have to be able to carry out. And if you don't do it this way, but you do it sequentially, then you will have exponentially many gates. So you need to be able to do this thing, this control thing. And this can be done. So this is why it's called the modular exponentiation and not modular multiplication, because this is the actual operation that you have to implement on a quantum computer, okay? In order to carry out Shor efficiently. And this is exactly what is written in this circuit, okay? So this is why I have written this in this way. Okay, time goes quickly. So now I need just to tell you about Shor. So how to factor with this. And this is very nice. So how do we factor n with this? Okay, and this is possible thanks to two theorems. The first theorem says that n, big N, is a L-bit integer, okay? X is a non-trivial solution of X square equal 1 modulo n. Non-trivial means that x is not 1 modulo n itself, okay? And that x is not m n minus 1 with m integer, which is equal to minus 1 modulo n. So these are the assumptions of this theorem. So x must be a non-trivial solution of this equation. Then at least one of greater common denominator of x minus 1 n and greater common denominator of x plus 1 n is a non-trivial factor of n. Okay, Now, this theorem is a number theoretical theorem. It seems strange, but actually, if we don't have to go too quickly, there is even a proof which is very simple. So what I'm saying is that suppose that you have n, your big number, and suppose that you find a non-trivial solution to this equation with square here. Right? This is a square. I'm very bad. Okay. So a non-trivial solution of this object, then you are done because you take the square root, okay, and then you compute the greatest common denominator of this number minus one and this number plus one, and one of the two at least will be a good factor of n. So the problem now is to solve this. Notice that computing the greatest common denominator as a classical algorithm, so computing. Computing GCD has a classical algorithm. It's called the Euclidean algorithm. And it's not very recent. It's 300 BC. Okay. And it works in order of log n to the power of 2. Okay, and there are also better algorithms, plus better algorithm. Okay, so this is the first theorem. And now the second theorem, important. The proof of the first is trivial. Perhaps I will show you. Suppose that so take the factored number. So take this as P1 to the alpha one up to Pm to the alpha m. And suppose that there are at least two different prime factors. We will see that otherwise it's easy to factor, okay? And suppose that n is odd, because if it's even, of course we have found a prime factor very easily. Okay. Take x, so one smaller than x, smaller than n minus one. So take an integer x like this. Suppose that x is coprime to n. So essentially, which means that this means essentially that they don't have common factors. So essentially, this means that x is in z n star. Let R be the order of x. Okay, the way we defined it, then the probability that R is even and x to the R over 2 is different of minus 1 modulo n. This probability is larger or equal that 1 minus 1 over 2 to the power of m. Now, of course, x to the r over 2 is obviously different from 1 modulo n. Because if it was so, then r would not be the order of n. Otherwise, R over 2 is order of N. Is the order of A, is the order of X. And we know that we are making the assumption that the order of X is R, not R over 2. Okay. So this result is very important. Why? Because you see that here M is the number of prime factors. if there is only one, so if m is equal one, then factoring n is trivial. It can be done in polynomial time. So you have at least two in order for the domain to be difficult. If you have two, then this is 3/4. This probability is 3/4, which is large with respect to 1/2. And then you can, by iterating the procedure, you can make the probability of finding this number arbitrarily close to one. And now we can write the algorithm. So Shor's algorithm, and then I'm finished. Okay, so Shor's algorithm is the following. Given n, so one, n is even, done. Okay, two, n equal a to the b, for integers a larger than 3 and b larger than 2. Well, this is also done. Why? Because search for b requires order of log n attempts. Okay, because log on the basis 3 of n is equal to b log basis 3 of a, which is larger than b, because a is larger than 3, so the log on basis 3 is larger than 1. And this means that b is smaller than log on basis 3 of n. So it's enough to test. It's enough to test, so test b square root of n, okay, which is equal to n to the 1 over b, for b equal 2, 3, up to log 3 of n. So it's a few tests. You need just a few tests. So this is trivial. So you see that you need at least two different prime factors. And this explains, so this m must be at least 2, which means that this number is larger than 1/2. Then 1 over 2. Okay. 3. Randomly choose x between 1 and then minus 1. Okay. Compute GCD of xn. And then larger than one, done. Because it means that they have a common factor. So we have found the factor of G. Equal one, okay, equal one, go to 4, go to 0.4. Okay, so 4, use quantum order finding to find R. Okay, so the order of X. Of X. So remember, this means X to the R modulo N is equal to 1. Okay. 5. So this is the quantum, quantum inside. Okay, 5. If R is even and X to the R over 2 is different of minus one modulo n. Okay, then compute GCD of x to the r minus r over 2 minus 1 n and GCD of x to the r over 2 plus 1 n. Okay. Theorem 2. At least one is a non-trivial factor of n with probability larger than 3/4. This is the m equal to case, which is the worst case. Okay, if m is larger, this probability is even larger. Okay. If not, so here there are several things. So this condition may not happen. Okay. But this is with probability smaller than 1/4. If not, go back to four. Go back to three. Go back to three. And since this probability is large, with large probability, you will end up with a factor. With probability close to one, you will end up with a factor. So this is the idea. Okay, this is the algorithm. Okay, and the reason why it works is that it works because if x to the r modulo n is equal to one, so essentially this is the outcome of point four. Okay, we find the order, then define y equal x to the r over two, which we can because r is even with p close to one with large probability, okay, due to the second theorem, okay, and also different from minus one, okay. Then, because of this, we have that y squared is equal to x to the r, so it means that this is equal to m times n, where m is an integer, plus one. This means that y squared minus one is equal to an integer. Okay, this means that y minus one times y plus one is equal to mn. And therefore, y minus one, y plus one divided by n is equal to m, which is an integer, which tells you that at least one of these two numbers, y minus one and y plus one, must have a common factor with n, because otherwise this fraction can't give an integer. Okay, so this fraction, this is only possible, if y minus one or y plus one have common factor with n, which by the way is the proof of theorem one. Okay, and this is all, that's it. This is the algorithm. You can make an example. Example. The one that is always done on small quantum computers, okay? N equal 15. It's the smallest non-trivial number to factor, okay? Suppose that you choose randomly x equals 7. Okay, so point one and so x is odd. No, sorry, n is odd. Okay, so it's not cannot be divided by two. Point two, n is different from a to the b, obvious. Okay, point three, x equals 7 belongs to the z 15 star because 7 and 15 do not have common factors. Okay, four, x to the r modulo n equal to 1, exhaustive search because the number is small, you find that r equal 4. Try it. Okay. Five, r is even. Fantastic. So it's good. X square modulo 15 is equal to 4. So it's different from minus 1. Great. So theorem 2 is satisfied. We have found the number that we are looking for. And now we compute the GCD of 3.15 because 4 minus 1 is 3 and is equal to 3. And GCD of 5.15 is equal to 5. So here both are good. So we found in one run of our pseudo-Shor algorithm, both factors. That's the way it works. Okay.
Very nice.
Oof. Stop. Questions?
That was fantastic. Thank you, Vincenzo.
Yeah.
For the great lecture. We already have a question.
I know it's late, sorry.
No worries. I learned a lot personally. So the first question is, what are the largest numbers we can practically factor today?
With Shor or in general?
Quantum computer or in general?
Okay, quantum computer, I wrote it down here. Wait a moment, because I want to give you a good answer here. I wrote it down because, did anybody tell you that the very first quantum computers were made with the nuclear magnetic resonance and they were made with molecules in liquid? So they were actually flasks.
we actually have Leven van der Sijpen next. Who did the 15 factorization experiment.
Oh, I see. No, I think that with NMR, I wrote it down, but now I can't find it. I wrote down with NMR, they factored Shor's algorithm, the largest integer factored with Shor's algorithm is 21, with the true Shor's algorithm. With variational algorithms based on adiabatic quantum computer, they went up to 291,311. This was it's a six-digit number. This was factored with the variational algorithm, which shows that, like as one would expect, that today with today's hardware, variational algorithms are better, of course. Yes. The algorithm by Alanas Purugudzic has factored a number in the order of trillion. Now to the classical part. At EPFL, we have the person who made the largest amount of money out of factoring. We have Arjen Lenstra, professor in computer science, who started his career by writing algorithms to factor RSA. So you know that there was an RSA challenge. The RSA public key cryptography scheme is based on factoring. and elliptic curves. I mean, it's very complicated. I don't understand anything, but it's essentially can be traced back to factoring. And Arjen Lenstra started winning these contests. There's money, eh? There was money. Now it's finished. It's finished years ago, but he won many of them. You go on Wikipedia and look up RSA challenge and you will see his name pop up many times, okay? And the bottom line is that we can factor with this super sophisticated algorithm stuff up to, I think the largest RSA challenge is somewhere between 500 and 700 bits. I don't want to say nonsense, but it's somewhere, I think in the 700 bits has been done. Yeah, he won a lot of money with this.
Yeah.
Okay. And which shows that we are still far away, but you know how exponentials and polynomials go. I mean, at some point, hop, the exponential takes over and then it's finished. So yeah, we keep hoping. I mean, things are happening. I didn't have time on Tuesday to show you the error correction, but there is a huge progress in this field. So we keep hoping. There are other questions a bit everywhere. Largest number we've probably fatto today. So just the bottleneck from the class, this classically is quantum or defined. No. So the way a number is factored classically is completely different from what I told you. It's not this. I mean, if you try to do this classically, this is extremely inefficient, because the order is exponential, period. So this is not good, okay? Now, there is no, if, I mean, the there is no proof that the factoring problem is NP. For sure, it's not NP complete. I mean, at least I don't want to say nonsense in quantum in complexity, but if it was NP complete and we have Shor's algorithm, then it would go against the theorem that says that we can speed up NP complete problems by at most a square root, because this is an exponential speed up. So Shor should not be, as far as I understand, NP complete, but it's conjectured to be NP. So it's conjectured to be NP hard. So it's difficult to, it's exponential. However, we don't know. Maybe there is an algorithm out there and nobody discovered it. So there is no proof that it's exponentially hard. But for sure, if you apply this method classically, it's a mess. I mean, it's not the right way to go. And there is another question on the chat. You just posted the link to the RSA challenge. Okay, so yeah. Maybe you should invite Arjen Lenstra to tell us about this. Okay. Any other questions?
Well, all right. In that case, I had actually a paper about this adiabatic quantum computing that popped up recently. What was it? Digitized adiabatic quantum factorization by Enrique Solano.
Who's the last author is Enrique?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, it's. I was remembering that it was by Aspuro Gudzik, but is Aspuro Gudzik in the list of authors? No. Strange. I thought this this
came from China.
Or maybe it's another paper. It's still another paper.
Probably anyway, another one. Yes. Mm.
Anyway. It's interesting. Yeah. Yeah, but I mean, Giuseppe Garleo, who's quite an expert in these things, he says that probably when you go big, I mean, a variational algorithm is a minimization of a function that has many local minima, okay? And Giuseppe suspects then that I'm stating his opinion, but I talked to him and he pointed out that probably when you go big, the shape of this landscape is so complex that the any known optimization algorithm like gradient descent, stochastic gradient descent, that will have a very hard time. So when you work with a variation algorithm, you never know because of that. Shor is not variational. Shor is, a probabilistic quantum, but not variational.
Yes.
Okay, yeah. This is the beauty of it.
You have to run it a certain number of times, and then you will, with a certain probability.
But a very small number of times.
Yes.
That's the beauty of it. And also the beauty of it is that the reason why it's efficient is very subtle, because as I said, you take two pieces that can almost be classically simulated, you stick them together and the result is, just out of reach, which is beautiful in my opinion. Okay.
Fascinating. Thank you very much, Vincenzo.
Thank you. Thank you. This was really fun.
I agree. And then I think we'll have a 10 minutes break until 11, and then we'll have Lieven van der Sijpen to talk about spin qubits.
Great. I will send you these handwritten whiteboards.
That would be great. Okay. Okay. I think you can export them or print them as PDFs. From.
I will export them as PDF and we'll make a single file and send it to you. Perhaps not very soon because I have meetings all day, but I will try to be as quick as possible. Okay.
No worries.
So thank you very much, everybody. Bye-bye. Enjoy the
school. Thank you. Bye.